So for those of you who don't know, the tributes, it was requested that a junior member of the faculty where the people being honored are to give the tributes. Obviously, I don't qualify, but Dr. Petrosian, who was asked to give Dr. Randolph's tribute, asked me if I would write the script and he would do the video. So I agreed to do that, and I'll leave it up to your imagination who the narrator for this is. Would you please start the video?
Judson Graves Randolph, Judd to his close friends, Dr. Randolph to everyone else, was born in Macon, Georgia, but grew up and was educated in Nashville, Tennessee, where his father was the financial editor for the Nashville Banner, which explains the extensive changes he requested on any manuscript for which he was a co-author. He trained in general surgery at the Massachusetts General Hospital and in pediatric surgery with Dr. Robert Gross, who he revered, at the Boston Children's Hospital, completing that training in 1960. He was recruited to the Children's Hospital in Washington, D.C. in 1963, much to the displeasure of the adult surgeons who practiced children's surgery there on a part-time basis. He established the 13th Pediatric Surgery Training Program in North America at the Washington, D.C. Children's Hospital in 1964 by accepting John Lilly as the first fellow, although Dr. Randolph preferred to call the fellows chief residents. He trained R. Peter Altman and Kathy Anderson and hired both as faculty, creating a group of three who would all become APSA presidents. Dr. Randolph was instrumental in the development of three critical events that established pediatric surgery as a specialty separate from general adult surgery. Number one, the criteria for pediatric surgery fellowships. Number two, the special competence in pediatric surgery certificate of the American Board of Surgery. And three, the exam to obtain that certificate, which he created with Drs. Harvey Beardmore and Mark Rowe. Dr. Randolph was the first pediatric surgeon to represent the specialty of pediatric surgery on the American Board of Surgery. Dr. Randolph claimed that he chose a surgical career because he was a mediocre athlete in high school, but saw that surgeons had a locker, uniforms, worked as a team, and could be as good as they wanted to be, no matter what they weighed. He loved to operate and teach, and although he was a surgical traditionalist, he was always seeking innovative surgical solutions to complex pediatric problems. Dr. Randolph was devoted to his wife, Comfort, and their five children. Comfort kept him grounded and was famous for her honest appraisal of him. When Dr. Randolph was going to ask Dr. Gross for a junior pediatric surgery spot, she told him, "Don't write him a letter, go in person, because you are a lot better in person than on paper." Dr. Randolph had charisma and an insight into people's feelings that were legendary, and was in constant communication with his many past trainees by handwritten letters, usually on box-lined graph paper. He loved the outdoors and playing golf, but his go-for-broke philosophy of life was not consistent with low scores. He had a wonderful self-deprecatory sense of humor that was evident when he recalled being in a hotel that was holding a meeting of podiatric surgeons, and he quipped, "There, but for a vowel, goes I." Dr. Randolph was one of the pillars on which APSA's foundation rests, and he is sorely missed by all who knew and loved him.
Thank you.
Thank you, Phil, for such a moving tribute on behalf of Dr. Randolph. Well, good morning, and my name is Craig Lillehei, and together with my co-chair, Chuck Snyder, and our entire professional development committee, we'd like to welcome you to the very first APSA Tech Talks. Our recent APSA presidents, Ron Herschel and Henri Ford, actually repurposed and renamed Waldhausen's PSAP subcommittee to identify and charged us to identify, prioritize, and then address the knowledge and practice gaps within our specialty. So today, you're going to hear four talks on the top educational content of 2019. Now, Marge Arca actually deserves a shout out because she was the one who used the acronym for us. Obviously, playing off on the very familiar TED Talks, these are tech talks, but they're designed, as you'll see from the stage, in much the same way. We're also especially thankful to Whit Holcomb and the Journal of Pediatric Surgery for sponsoring this rather innovative activity. Our first speaker will actually review the 2018 topics, reminding us of that and showing us where we've headed. The one to do that is Dr. David Powell. Now, you know David Powell as APSA's Strategic Program Officer. Perhaps you know him as the editor of our pedsurgelibrary.com, but for most of us on any variety of committees, he's really our educational guru or our Zen master. So David, the podium is yours.
Thanks, Craig and Chuck. No, it's not a typo up there. This is 2019, which many of you are wondering, why are we talking about topics from 2018? Isn't that really old news? And this is why. And many of you who take our expert space learning program will understand this. It turns out if you teach a learner just once, they only really remember about a quarter of what you say. And the speakers up here should keep that in mind. If you teach them something a second time, that doubles their retention of what they've learned. Probably more importantly, if you ask them to problem solve with that information, that almost triples what they've learned. So let's do a little space learning and, most importantly, talk about a few patients. Let's talk about a day in the operating room. Your first case is an ileostomy closure in a teenager who had this done for complicated inflammatory bowel disease. As you're finishing the case, which took a little more intraperitoneal dissection than you were hoping, the intern you've done the case with is called down to the emergency department to do a trauma, and horror of horror, you have to write the postoperative orders. Show of hands, you guys know I'm not a big fan of technology, so we're not going to use the ARS system. Show of hands, who would order for maintenance fluids D5, half normal, saline with 20 of KCL per liter? Like I would. Unfortunately, I and you would be wrong. Turns out that the use of hypotonic fluids, such as half normal saline, really contributes to iatrogenic hyponatremia in these patients. It's probably more appropriate to use an isotonic fluid, such as normal saline and maybe even lactated ringers, that isn't associated with a hypo or hypernatremia and decreases the risk of having seizures from those electrolyte abnormalities. That was our number four tech topic from 2018. All right, next patient. Between cases, in that 3 or 4 minute turnover time that you have, you're asked to go downstairs to the emergency department and see a patient. This time a 9-year-old with right lower quadrant pain lasting 18 hours, focused right lower quadrant tenderness, a mild leukocytosis, an ultrasound that shows an enlarged appendix, but no fecalith and no free fluid. The parents have been Googling and are interested in this concept of non-operative management of appendicitis. Again, show of hands, how many people in the room would offer non-operative management for simple, complicated appendicitis? All right, don't shoot the messenger. Turns out that at the initial therapy, non-operative management of appendicitis is pretty damn good, 97% effective. If you measure the outcomes, they're pretty much equivalent to appendectomy, except that patients who have non-operative management have fewer disability days and are back at school quicker. The real proof is in the pudding is long-term, but even after a year, 80% of those children have avoided an appendectomy with a 14% recurrence rate. I'll leave it up to you whether those numbers are sufficient or not to offer non-operative management of appendicitis for your patients. All right, back up in the operating room, anesthesia's got the patient ready. You're presented with a toddler who presents with a large left abdominal mass that's palpable. The fellow tells you these are the studies and throws them up quickly on the computer. You can see the mass there. What is this likely to be? Wilms tumor. And the CT scan shows that there's a lung met. Again, show of hands. Stage 4 metastatic Wilms tumor. How many people would do a biopsy in a Broev? Turns out that the presence of metastatic disease, lung mets particularly, should not preclude the resection of the primary tumor for Wilms tumor. Wilms tumor protocol COG protocol violations were our number 2 top educational content for last year. What else do you need to do in addition to the nephrectomy? Somebody say it loudly. Lymph nodes, exactly right. If you do not sample, thank you. If you do not sample, you've been trained well. If you don't sample lymph nodes, they're kind of presumed to be positive and that upstages the patient. That's a real problem. So again, you can still resect the primary even if you have metastatic disease, and don't forget your lymph nodes. That was tech topic number 2. All right, let's go back. Your patient who you did the lap appy on, the parents agreed with you that laparoscopic appendectomy was the right thing to do. Now 12 hours later is ready to go home from the short stay unit. The intern is down, putting in a dislodged G-tube in the emergency department. And the nurse calls and wants to know, what are you going to write for pain medicine for this patient to go home? How many people, show of hands, would send a lap appy home with a narcotic prescription? I'm so proud of you. Those of you know that opioid-related deaths have quadrupled. Emergency department inpatient hospitalizations for overdose in children now has doubled. Most of the source of these opioids come from appropriately or legally written prescriptions from healthcare providers. A significant number of adolescents who are prescribed opiates will misuse and then subsequently abuse those opiates. And a pretty high number of them are still on opiates 30 or 60 days after their procedure. The suggestions are, don't prescribe opiates unless you know your patients need them. And for the vast majority of our procedures, they probably don't need a narcotic prescription. If you're gonna do a prescription, do a smaller quantity to limit the amount of pills that are out there in the community, all right? And then finally, you really need to encourage good practices for disposal of those opiates after the patient is done with them. For those of you who are interested, these were our top, and our David Letterman fans, these were our top 10 top educational content topics for 2018. All of these have questions and expert, all of these have learning objectives in the NAT. If you're interested or don't know why these are up here, that probably means you don't know why they're up here. So go to those resources and learn about it. I, for one, am really interested in what we have for the 2019 Tech Talks. And so who's our next speaker? Thank you.
Our next Tech Talk is Dr. Aaron Jensen from UCSF to talk to us a little bit about pediatric spine trauma. And I'd like just take a minute to thank the Felicity Huffman Foundation and the guy who took the board exam for me as well.
Wow. Morning, everybody. So I'd like to thank John Petty for asking me to give a tech talk. He said, hey, we're gonna do these TED Talks. They're gonna be inspirational, ideas worth talking about. Different format. I says, wow, that sounds great. He says, I want you to give your talk on C-spine injuries. Okay. I think we can be very inspirational about this. I think it seems pretty boring and pretty mundane, but this is actually an important issue for us. Let me ask for a show of hands. How many of you are gonna go back to work on Thursday and just send a kid home from the ED with an undiagnosed or missed cervical spine injury? Who wants to do that? Dr. Barksdale does, all right. Jeff Upperman, PEDS Trauma Man, Trauma Medical Director at Children's Hospital Los Angeles. Your trauma center wants to spend all these kids home with injuries? He says yes. Don't put that on Twitter. That's probably not a good thing. None of us want to send these kids home with injuries, right? And I think that visceral response of missing a cervical spine injury leads us all to overimage these kids. Show of hands, who thinks they overimage C-spines and trauma? Most of the room, right? And we're talking to a group of pediatric surgeons. So we are the experts in pediatric trauma, and we self-admittedly overimage. So the goals of my talk really are to provide you with some tools and some guidelines for how we can decrease imaging for cervical spine injury in kids. Who can we get away with not imaging with good outcomes in the long term? Talk about some cases to start. So I've changed all the names on these, but Sarah, I'm sure all of you have seen a kid like this, high-speed motor vehicle crash. She was restrained, wearing her seatbelt, airbag went off. Comes to your trauma bay, and she actually looks pretty good. GCS is normal, she's talking, no loss of consciousness, hemodynamics are normal. Her right shoulder hurts, and she's got terrible neck pain. Show of hands, who will screen this kid with plain films? Okay. Who's going to go straight to advanced imaging? Okay, CT, MRI. When I say advanced imaging, CT, MRI. Okay, so and about half people didn't vote. Does that mean you're just going to clear them clinically with neck pain? Okay, so half the people aren't voting. Hopefully by the end of my talk, we'll get everybody engaged in voting, and I hope I don't fall off this stage because it's really small. All right, so she comes in and she gets wonderful, beautiful plain films. And this is pretty typical in kids. They've got nice thin necks, not a lot of chronic changes. These are beautiful. You don't quite see down to the top of T1 on the lateral, but you see a nice, beautiful set of C-spines. These are normal. The radiologist says they're normal. They're great views. Except she's got this wicked clavicle fracture on the right side, which is leading to her pain. No focal neurodeficits. She just has pain. Who wants to clear her now, clinically? Just take her collar off. Nobody? Okay, good. Who wants to go to advanced imaging now if you didn't do so before? So 3, 4, 5. Who wants to just send her home in a collar and re-examine her? It's really hard to see with these lights, but about 6 or 8 people, looks like, and still nobody's voting. That's great. All right, so I'm actually a big fan of sending these kids home in a collar. Unfortunately, the collar sits right on top of that clavicle fracture, and that really hurts. So her compliance with that collar is probably gonna be pretty minimal. She's 14, she can get an MRI without sedation, and the scanner was available, so we sent her over for an MRI. And it shows she does have a ligamentous injury. Her ligamentum flavum is torn at C7 on T1. This is not an unstable injury, does not need surgery, needs a collar for 6 weeks. So we could have sent her out in a collar and probably treated her without the MRI, but this gives you a little bit more information, a little bit more motivation for her to wear her collar that probably hurts over her right shoulder. But I think this is pretty typical of the MRIs that we get in these kids who have normal plain films, that they do have these ligamentous injuries, but none of them are unstable, and they almost never need a surgery. Let's talk about another kid, Devin, he's 12. He was in a car similar to that white one, restrained front seat passenger, and was hit by a car similar to that black one, a big SUV head on. And Devin's in pretty rough shape. He's taken to a local receiving center, which is not a pediatric trauma center. He's hypotensive, his GCS is 8, and they intubate him. And as most non-pediatric trauma centers do, they do a PAN scan, and it's quite an impressive scan. He's got lots of injuries, including a head injury. He's transferred to our pediatric trauma center for management of all of his injuries. And you can see some of his imaging here. He's got a little epidural, but he turns out to have a much more severe TBI as he has some contusions that flower in the next 24 hours and doesn't really wake up all that much. But he got a real PAN scan, top of his head down to the bottom of his feet at the adult center. And he's got some pretty bad femur fractures that on the first day, because of his head and instability, he just got X fixes and got his open fracture washed out. And then he has to go back to the OR the next day to get the left side nailed. And then he goes back the next day to get the right side fixed because we wanted to limit the amount of anesthesia time because of his head injury. So 3 OR trips in 3 days. Anybody seen a patient like this? Okay. So unfortunately, Devin is kind of a big kid, and he was a difficult intubation. We did extubate him in the ICU, and when they had to re-intubate him for a second operation, this isn't him, clearly, he doesn't have a C-collar on, but he's a little obese, he's immobilized, he's gotten a lot of fluid, and it was a difficult intubation. So they nasotracheally intubate him with a scope, and anesthesia does not want to take that out. They're going to leave the endotracheal tube in for 3 days because he's got all these planned reoperations. He already has a completely normal, high-quality, high-resolution CT scan. In that 12-hour period that he was extubated, he wasn't following commands, but he has a non-focal exam. He moves all extremities. He withdraws from pain. Who would send this kid for an MRI so they can get the collar off within the first 24 to 48 hours? Okay, About 6, 8, 10% of the audience, okay. Who will just leave him in the collar until he's awake and examinable and clear him when he's clearable, okay? Who wants to just take the collar off based on a normal CT scan? 1, 2, you've been reading the adult data. I like it. We're going to talk about that in a little bit. All right, cool. So I named this kid Aaron after me because this is something that I probably would do. So a little 5-year-old boy was sent to his room for timeout because he wasn't behaving. And dad was going to go to the Warrior game. Had to throw something in there about the Warriors. And he was mad that he didn't get to go. So he climbed out his window. And he fell and hit the roof and then fell onto dad's car and sort of bounced his way down all the way to the driveway. It was a first floor fall, but he had lots of things on the way down to break his fall. I could totally see myself doing this when I was 5. He comes in, he looks like a million bucks. No loss of consciousness, he cried immediately. He's complaining of terrible arm pain and a little bit of leg pain, but otherwise looks fine. Who wants to screen this kid with plain films? Okay, most of the audience. Advanced imaging right away. Who wants to get a CT of this kid's C-spine? Nobody, it looks like. Maybe one in the back? Okay. Well, unfortunately, he didn't go to a pediatric trauma center. He went somewhere else where they pan scanned everything, head, neck, chest, abdomen, pelvis, which, of course, all was negative, and he could have been cleared clinically with clinical prediction models. And he did have a broken arm that ended up needing to be fixed. I think of all the things I'm talking about today, this is the one problem that we as pediatric surgeons need to address. We need to take ownership of this problem. We need to take ownership of the over-imaging, over-radiation of trauma patients at non-pediatric centers. I think we in our own centers do a great job of not imaging kids that don't need imaging. But we need to get the word out. So at the end, I'll share you with a tool that we can use to get the word out. Okay, so we have different mechanisms, different injuries, different ways to image, all these moving parts. So how can we make sense of these things? So the first thing I'll point you to, and I'm not going to go through all these guidelines, but these are really good guidelines. So these were written in 2013 by the AANS and CNS. Evidence-based guidelines. The best evidence in here is level 1, which says that if you want to diagnose atlanto-occipital dissociation, you should get a CT scan. I think that's pretty clear. Everything else is grade 2 and grade 3. Best thing about these is they tell us who doesn't need imaging. Who can we clinically clear without a single x-ray? Okay? This is another thing that if you can just walk away with the first set of guidelines and know who you can get away with not imaging safely and share that with your adult centers, that would be huge. So kids you can communicate with, GCS 14 or 15, who are not intoxicated, you can clear clinically. Unless they have a painful, distracting injury. 3 and under is an interesting population because they don't communicate all that well. But most of the time, you can clear them. But the data suggests that if they have a high-risk mechanism of injury, particularly child abuse, where C-spine injury rates are very high, if they have one of these high-risk mechanisms, even if they seem totally fine, you should screen them radiographically. Okay. Clinical clearance involves no neurologic deficits, so you actually have to do a neuro exam. No midline cervical tenderness, no painful distracting injury, and no unexplained hypotension. And then they have to be able to move their head in all directions without distraction, without any limitation. Clinical clearance works in a defined population of kids. And I think if we stick to this guideline, we can really cut down on the amount of imaging. The problem with this is the guidelines don't really tell us what to do when the neck hurts. What do you do with that kid who you can't clear them? The evidence for this is, quite frankly, terrible. I can't tell you what to do with these kids, but there are many options, and the evidence is emerging as to what we can do with these kids to, again, decrease the risk of radiation. So we talked about this kid earlier. Normal plain films, but still has neck pain. So do all these kids really need to go get an MRI in the ED, or do they need to be admitted overnight so they can get an MRI with sedation the next day? You're going to give a kid general anesthesia to get an MRI. Or can they be sent home with cervical collar from the ED with follow-up in 1 to 2 weeks with a reattempt to clear them clinically? I think the biggest concern here is, are we sending potentially unstable injuries out of the ED, and what if that kid takes their collar off and there's a lapse and they have a neurologic deficit because we sent them home in a collar, and we don't know that compliance is going to be 100%. So there's a great paper out of Boston a few years old now. They looked at 300 kids who had no fractures on their imaging in the ED. And they followed them up. They actually had 94% follow-up. That's pretty good. The bottom 2 points are the most important. Only 2% of these kids had a ligamentous injury on their MRI, and none of them required surgery. None of them were unstable. So it actually is safe to send kids out from the ED in a collar. 84% of the kids that were sent out in a collar had it clinically cleared at their first clinic visit 1 to 2 weeks later. 84%. That's a lot of MRIs we can cut down on. That's a lot of CT scans we can cut down on. 10% required persistent use of the collar beyond the first visit, referral to neurosurgery, subspecialty follow-up, and MRI. But again, very few of those patients who had normal initial imaging had an injury that required surgery. They only lost 18 kids to follow-up. I think this is what we all worry about. You send a kid out in a collar, are they going to come back? And this is going to vary by center. I would hope that those kids would have come back if they developed neck pain or symptoms, but that is always the biggest concern of sending kids home in a collar. What about the kid who's obtunded in the ICU? Do we just clear him? Do we get an MRI? Do we wait? What do we do? Well, the thing we worry about are pressure ulcers. Anybody seen a pressure ulcer from a collar? Yeah, I saw three of them last year, and they can be pretty terrible. We all know who the patients are that get these. They occur 6 to 38%. They occur on the clavicles, back of the head, base of the neck. And these can be pretty bad. They occur in kids in the ICU. They occur in kids who get a lot of fluid. They occur in kids who have ICP monitors, who are on the ventilator. We know who these kids are. One of the biggest independent risk factors is whether or not you had to get an MRI to clear their C-spine. If they had to wait for their MRI, they were more likely to get an ulcer. But the real question is do they really need an MRI? And I think this is probably the biggest controversy right now, is whether or not these kids need an MRI. This is the adult data that I think some people have alluded to. This is a meta-analysis of 5 studies that looked at 1,000 patients that have normal, completely stone-cold normal CTs of their C-spine. No osteophytes, no degenerative disease, stone-cold normal CTs. Again, these are adult patients. They found on follow-up that 9% who ended up eventually getting an MRI had stable injuries that required no treatment. 91% had no injuries on either MRI or clinical follow-up. The most important part is that no single patient in these 1,000 that had a stone-cold normal CT scan required surgery to fix an injury. So these were all stable injuries. So the recommendation in adults now is to take the collar off with a normal CT scan and don't send these patients to MRI. I don't think this is applicable to kids. We know that kids have greater frequency of ligamentous injury, unstable ligamentous injury, but we are now going to start getting pressure to clear collars based on CTs. I think we as a community need to come together and reproduce this study in kids. We could come up with 1,000 patients easily amongst our centers. Let's try to define that subset of kids that this actually applies to. I actually think this would apply to kids who are in the sort of preteen to teenage years, but the 5-year-old probably not. I think this needs more definition. But I do think we need to figure out how to get these collars off quicker, and sending a polytrauma patient to the MR scanner is not without risk. Finally, what about the kid like me who fell out of the roof and got pan scanned? What do we do about this problem? I think this is a rampant problem. We get lots of transfers from non-pediatric trauma centers that have been pan scanned without a real indication for that other than mechanism. I would like everybody to know about this new resource from the American College of Surgeons TQIP program. This is a free download. You can all download it today. This was written by adult trauma surgeons, and it includes standardized evidence-based guidelines for imaging in trauma patients. We had a seat at the table. So there were 5 of us, Dr. Gaines, Dr. Bird, Dr. Malik, Dr. Falcone, and myself, spent hours upon hours on conference calls discussing these things, and we made sure that there are pediatric-specific sections for CT of the head, C-spine, whole body CT, chest imaging, so forth and so on. There are evidence-based guidelines in here that you can share with adult trauma centers, with non-trauma centers, so that they can follow these for their imaging of pediatric trauma patients. I would ask that you download this, familiarize yourself with this, and use this in your outreach efforts to your referral centers that are sending you these patients. In summary, we have a huge opportunity to decrease radiation sedation resource utilization in these patients. I think that there are reasonable guidelines that exist, but we really need to improve these, and the only way to improve these is for us to be at the table, generating data, strengthening these guidelines, and really reaching out to the adult centers so that we can provide our expertise for them. Thank you for your time, and I'm not sure if we're going to take questions later, but look forward to talking to you at the break.
Thank you. It was excellent. And next is Dr. Aaron Rowell from Lurie Children's Hospital to talk to us a little bit about fertility preservation in children with cancer.
Thank you. Thanks so much. Thank you so much. Thank you, APSA colleagues and the Program Development Committee for the opportunity to speak today. I plan to explain why pediatric surgeons are important advocates for fertility preservation in children with cancer. Due to the dramatic increases in survival and cancer therapy over the past 30 years, today, 7 out of 8 children with cancer will survive. Adult survivors of childhood cancer experience late effects of treatment. Infertility is cited as the most significant long-term quality of life issue for adult survivors. Multiple professional societies, including the American Academy of Pediatrics, the American Society for Reproductive Medicine, and the American Society of Clinical Oncology, recommend a discussion of fertility preservation options for every patient prior to undergoing gonadotoxic chemotherapy. Overall, we have room to improve in how we educate patients and families about infertility options to preserve fertility. Anna Zotto and colleagues, in a recent systematic review of worldwide practice, found that pre-treatment discussion of fertility preservation options ranges from 9% to 78%, depending on country, location, type of hospital, and that patients and families initiate the discussion in 23 to 50% of cases. So, what are the options? Post-pubertal and adult males can bank sperm because they produce mature sperm after puberty. However, pre-pubertal boys produce immature spermatocytes, and testicular tissue cryopreservation, or freezing of testicular tissue, is the only option available prior to treatment. This is an experimental option and requires testicular biopsy. Post-pubertal girls and adult women can bank embryos because they produce mature eggs. However, many post-pubertal girls cannot undergo the 2 to 3 weeks of hormone stimulation necessary for egg harvesting, and embryo banking is not an option for pediatric patients for legal and ethical reasons. Pre-pubertal girls have ovaries which contain their entire supply of follicles, just over 1 million primordial follicles at birth, and these will decline over the lifetime of the female to reach 1,000 to trigger menopause at around age 50. Ovarian tissue cryopreservation, or freezing of ovarian tissue, is the only option available for fertility preservation in prepubertal girls. It is considered experimental and is achieved by surgical unilateral oophorectomy, typically with a laparoscopic approach. Alkylating chemotherapy, radiation, and stem cell transplant protocols place patients at the highest risk for infertility due to direct toxicity to the growing germ cells and to depletion of the primordial follicle pool. This is why males experience azoospermia and females experience premature ovarian insufficiency, which is menopause symptoms 15 to 20 years earlier than expected due to reaching the trigger point of 1,000 follicles earlier than expected. This graph depicts depletion in the primordial follicle reserve that occurs in a 10-year-old with 12 gray of radiation to the abdomen, and menopause symptoms ensue at approximately 19 and a half years. This flowchart demonstrates the options for prepubertal girls being ovarian tissue banking and postpubertal girls who are not able to undergo hormone stimulation. This flowchart demonstrates the options for prepubertal boys being, I'm trying to find the pointer here, being testicular biopsy, and for mature post-adolescent males to bank sperm. In 2014, the American Academy of Pediatrics Surgical Advisory Panel recommended that patients 5 years or younger who may need surgical care should be cared for by a pediatric surgeon, and that minimally invasive procedures in infants and children should be performed by a pediatric surgeon trained in those techniques. We are trained to do laparoscopic oophorectomy in children and testis biopsy in children. This photo shows a laparoscopic review of a 2-year-old female during unilateral oophorectomy for ovarian tissue cryopreservation. Note the thin ovary on a long fallopian tube pedicle, the small size of the pelvis, and the very small size of the ovary. And yet, that ovary contains hundreds of thousands of primordial follicles. This photo is an intraoperative view of a testis biopsy in a 2-year-old. These are straightforward outpatient procedures that ought to be performed safely with excellent hemostasis, delicate handling of the tissues, and no delay to definitive medical therapy. Pediatric surgeons often have early involvement in patients with a new cancer diagnosis through mass resection or biopsy, through lymphadenectomy, through central venous access. We can advocate for early fertility preservation education through discussion with our colleagues as treatment plans are developed. We know that certain protocols with cyclophosphamide equivalent dose, or CED, of greater than 4 grams per meter squared in males and post-adolescent females, and radiation to the abdomen and pelvis place children at significant risk for infertility. Families indicate that they want fertility preservation education regardless of the infertility risk, but we should absolutely ensure that those patients at highest risk, 80% or greater, understand that and understand the options. Thinking about limiting anesthesia exposure by combining procedures under one anesthetic and avoiding delay in medical therapy are critical and require fertility preservation counseling and education early to plan for that one anesthetic exposure at the same time of the venous port insertion, or to plan to do the procedure after 1 or 2 cycles of therapy at an appropriate time and prior to the patient receiving high gonadotoxic doses. Again, the 80% or higher risk, and then 20 to 80%. In general, 50% or higher and a survival of at least 5 years are criteria for surgical fertility preservation option in a prepubertal child. This is real, and the future holds great promise for our pediatric patients for fertility preservation and restoration. Since 2004, when the first pregnancy was achieved after reimplantation of ovarian tissue, there have been over 130 live births worldwide. This has prompted many adult providers to recommend removing the experimental label for ovarian tissue cryopreservation, and some pediatric providers have also begun to advocate that so that we allow just access to the procedures for pediatric patients. In 2016, in London, a 24-year-old woman gave birth to a full-term baby using ovarian tissue, which had been cryopreserved at age 9 years prior to bone marrow transplant for beta thalassemia. Her tissue had been cryopreserved for 13 years, and she displayed signs of early menopause indicating premature ovarian insufficiency in her 20s. Recently, in a very important scientific discovery, a baby primate was born using prepubertal testicular tissue, which had been cryopreserved and then reimplanted and matured. A 3D printed bioprosthetic ovary is another important recent discovery, which has resulted in birth of mouse pups from follicles implanted into the ovary. This could be an important option for our pediatric patients in whom it would not be safe to reimplant whole tissue due to risk of reimplanting malignancy. One thing is for certain. Our pediatric patients have the advantage of time and rapid scientific progress regarding both their cancer treatment and their long-term quality of life issue of infertility. We can do our part by ensuring that our patients receive appropriate education to understand the options and by participating in safe surgery for fertility preservation whenever we can. Thank you, and I'll be happy to answer questions. I'm not sure if there's time for questions.
I think we decided we probably did not have time for questions.
Okay. Thanks so much.
Before I introduce our penultimate tech speaker today, I've been asked to remind everyone that videos from all this will be available on APSA's new and improved website, probably within the next couple of weeks or so. I don't think the time for that is not clear. But now our next speaker is Dr. Sean Rangel from a little workshop down the street to talk about antibiotics and surgery in pediatric surgery.
Great. Well, thank you, Chuck. And good morning, everyone. And I have to join Aaron in his comments that when I was asked to do an inspirational TED talk on antibiotic stewardship, I got a little bit of a knot in my stomach because it's not really the sexiest topic that you're going to hear about at APSA, nor the most exciting. But what I do hope to persuade you today is that it is among the most important. And this is not only because of the obvious relationship between stewardship and the public health crisis that we know as antimicrobial resistance, but also our role as pediatric surgeons in the problem as well as the potential solution. And it's really going to require that we work together. Now, why now should we care about this as pediatric surgeons? You know, this is something that's not new. We've all seen these news reports of the superbugs, right? That these are bugs that are resistant to just about every single antibiotic that we throw at them. But this is not new, and we can even say that some of these, you know, reports are a bit stale and they really don't raise eyebrows anymore. But what you may not know or really appreciate is the scope and the magnitude and the trajectory of this problem, much of which has not been well characterized or even appreciated until just the past couple of months. Now, how bad is it, and does it impact the patients, the pediatric patients that we care about? Well, there was a recent CDC study that just came out last month, and they estimate that over 2 million patients a year suffer from infections with resistant organisms in the hospital. And this comes at an annual cost of roughly $20 billion per year. And this is largely due to the prolonged hospitalization that's required to treat these infections. Now, that's staggering when you think about the fiscal imperative of this, but think about 23,000 Americans die every year from these infections. No, that's staggering. And then when you back up and think, well, who are the segments of society that are impacted most by these trends? It's the elderly and it's the extremely young, with the largest impact seen in children under 1 year of age, right? So this is a very real problem and it definitely impacts the patient populations that we care about. So what about us as pediatric surgeons? You know, what is our role in this? Well, part of it is awareness, it's knowledge, and understanding what we do in terms of our practice with antibiotic utilization, and what should we do? Well, there's pretty good data emerging as well that we have a lot of work to do, and there's plenty of opportunity. There was a recent study of freestanding children's hospitals, and it showed that over 40% of all patients undergoing clean surgical procedures without foreign body implantation receive unindicated antibiotic prophylaxis. Right, that's fairly alarming. And that's just the tip of the iceberg. If we look at patients who get antibiotics appropriately in terms of indication, over 50% of those patients will get their antibiotic prophylaxis extended well past the incision closure. For cases such as colorectal procedures, the average duration is 2.5 days of prophylaxis. And remember that these are elective procedures, right? These are not emergent procedures. When we think about antibiotic spectrum, almost 30% of patients will receive an agent which is well broader than the recommended guidelines. Double coverage is common, right? Flagyl and Zosyn, anyone heard of those two? Right, that's only quite frequently. Antibiotic utilization, right? So anaerobic coverage for proximal GI cases, the stomach, the small bowel, that's very common as well. So it appears to be a lot of opportunity that we can focus on and improve upon as us as pediatric surgeons. Now, part of the learning objective today is not only to educate and make people aware of what we do and what we should be doing in terms of current consensus guidelines, but also coming up with a prioritization framework. What should we be doing as pediatric surgeons that we can make the biggest impact in improving stewardship within our field? So, and back to Dr. Powell's comment about the top 10 list. Well, these are the top 3 situations, topics, events in pediatric surgery which is responsible for about 85% of the inappropriate use of what we do in this room. The runaway winner is giving prophylaxis for clean cases without foreign body implantation, about 50%. Prophylaxis after incision closure is number two, and then finally giving, again, anaerobic coverage for proximal stomach and small bowel procedures. These are the top three, again, 80 to 85% of all the inappropriate utilization. So what I challenge everyone today to do is pick one of these. Go back to your department and a faculty meeting, begin the discussions, dialogue, right? What do we do? How do we practice within our department? How does it align with these guidelines? And can we begin to think about perhaps becoming a little bit more compliant with these guidelines? What do we need to do to accomplish that? Now, for everyone who's equal opportunity in this room, I'd strongly suggest number one, right? So not only because that is the most important thing we can do collectively to improve stewardship, but also it's probably the lowest hanging fruit, right? It's a lot easier to not give antibiotics for clean cases than to persuade people to choose a different agent or maybe even shorten their duration. Now, there's another important reason to tackle number one, and that is between APSA and the ACS and NESQIP are starting to develop resources of other institutions who have successfully addressed number one that can be shared so you can be more successful with this as well. Okay? And so that's a nice segue into another critical message of the talk, and that is collaboration, right? Working together and sharing resources to combat the problem, right? And so this is really taking a page from the bacteria playbook in terms of what we can share to address the bigger picture. Now, there's an important reality check here as well, right? So I can tell you what the three priorities are. I can challenge you to go back to your departments and make a difference. But that's pretty, it's tough, right? It's tough to make change. You have to go back and deal with a lot of personalities. You have to project manage. You have to change culture. And that's typically something that us surgeons, we didn't train to do, right? And there's also cost, there's resources, there's a lot of potential barriers. And so the opportunity to leverage the successes of other people in this room who have successfully carried out these stewardship projects, that can be really invaluable, particularly if we want to move the needle across the entire field, right? Very important in terms of collaboration. So what I wanted to do is spend a few minutes to talk about two potential resources that might be particularly valuable for those of you who want to go back and change the culture of stewardship within your organizations. The first is our own pediatric surgery library. You saw a slide about this at the very beginning of the session. And for those of you who haven't checked out the new website, it is awesome. Lots of great resources, educational resources, and it also has a section at the lower left corner, quality improvement toolkits. So what are those? So the toolkits are descriptions of successful quality and process improvement projects that you've all done at your institutions. Okay. In addition to those descriptions, there's also practical resources about how to emulate and carry those out at your own institutions. Right? Things about rollout plan, how to change the culture, pitfalls, barriers, and a mentorship structure. So every one of these toolkits also has a sponsor from you in the audience who is available to mentor institutions about how to take that back to your institution and successfully carry it out. Now, there also happens to be a new section dedicated to antibiotic stewardship. And later on this afternoon, you're going to hear a few more details about one such project, which has to do with a little bit of our own dirty laundry down the street at Boston Children's. So there was a point where we overused antibiotics for clean surgical cases. Again, that's not in compliance with guidelines. And I can't tell you too much more because one of our fellows is going to give you a little bit more about the punchline and the details this afternoon in the toolkit session. But what I can tell you is we made a huge impact and significantly decreased this utilization. But it was hard. When I took this to my boss, Bob Schammerger, I told him we have to do this. This is really important. And like always, he was very supportive, but he kind of chuckled, laughed too. And he says, you know, if you can change this group, good luck. Because, you know, we have a lot of knuckleheads, and we also have Craig Lillehei, old dogs, and it's hard to teach them new tricks, right? He didn't really say that, but, and I know wherever Dr. Schammerger is sitting, he's telling the person next to him, I did not say that, I swear, right? But the fact was it was very difficult. It was challenging, right? I have like 24, 25, 26 partners, it's really hard to keep track. I don't know most of them, actually, right? But there are a lot of issues, right? A lot of personalities, a lot of people to align. And we took a faculty meeting, the entire faculty meeting, to hash this out, to address misconceptions and get people on the same page, and we did it. So if we can do that at my institution, you guys can definitely do it at your institutions as well. And again, please don't miss the afternoon session because you'll hear more about how we did that and how we can help you accomplish the same thing. The second resource is Pediatric NESQIP, and this is familiar to most everyone in the room, I would imagine. But what you may not know is in the last 3 to 5 years, we've really changed the type of data that we collect and compare among institutions. And there's ever more of an emphasis on collaboration and knowledge sharing. And last year, we launched the first collaborative among 84 hospitals, I believe the largest collaborative of children's hospitals ever, which was dedicated to antibiotic stewardship. And this is formally supported by the college as well. So a large part of this collaborative is webinars and a set of breakout sessions which are dedicated to stewardship, best practices, ideas, projects, and it's really meant to be complementary to what we're trying to develop within the APSA toolkits. Right, so a lot of the same folks are working on both to try to keep them complementary. Right? The other very unique aspect about the collaborative is that all 84 hospitals are collecting an extended set of prophylaxis utilization data. So we're going to be generating report cards based on current consensus guidelines for hospitals to use. So not only will they have that collaborative framework of knowledge sharing, but they'll have data to know where they should focus their quality improvement efforts, where they're needed most within their own institution. And so for those of you who are part of Pediatric NESQIP, right, as part of the hospitals, and this is a complete, you know, this is absolutely news to you, reach out to your surgeon champion and ask them about it. Or you can even reach out to me, and I can give you more background information and how to get engaged and let you know what we're going to be doing in the future. Okay. So in concluding, I did want to leave you with another sobering statistic, or more accurately, probably a projection. So the data I showed you before from the CBC, 23,000 deaths per year, that's quite alarming because that's happening now. But that pales in comparison to what will happen in the future if the continuing trends, or if the trends continue. So there was a study that came out last month from the UK, and this was commissioned by their CDC equivalent, and they projected that in 2050, 10 million patients will die from resistant infections. Again, if the current trends are not averted. That is staggering. Now, will Big Pharma come to rescue us? Well, the trends would also suggest that that's not going to be the case. Over the past 2 decades, the relative proportion of budgets dedicated to the development of new antimicrobials has decreased substantially and is now less than 5% on most of the big pharmacy companies. And with that, we've also seen a parallel decrease and the number of new antimicrobials. And this is not going to change anytime soon. So this is up to us. We have to own this. And we have to be more responsible, and we have to be more thoughtful with our antibiotic utilization. But we can make a difference, and we can move the needle with awareness and knowledge and working together. And collaboratively, I think we can make it better for our patients. And this is going to be very important for the well-being of our future surgical patients as well. So again, thank you for the opportunity to spread our message today and for your attention. Thank you. Yeah.
I got a text during his talk from one of the audience members saying that this was more exciting than season 8 of Game of Thrones. Next is Dr. Samir Gattapelli from the University of Michigan to tell us why we should use antibiotics in sepsis.
Hi, good morning. Sepsis is a surgical problem. Yeah, I said it. Sepsis is a surgical problem. There are 70,000 children that are hospitalized every year in the United States. 7,000 of them die from sepsis. That's 3 times more than pediatric cancers, about 20 a day. So in this last hour, when you heard these TED Talks, a child died of sepsis. Hashtag facts, you can tweet that. I'm Samir Gattapelli. I'm a pediatric surgeon and a surgical intensivist at the University of Michigan. So I round on our ICU patients, I write notes and orders, I intubate, I manage ventilators. Actually, I don't write notes and orders, I have fellows for that, but pretty much everything else. And so what I hope to do in this talk is to prepare and energize everybody in the audience out here to go out there and save some children's lives from sepsis. So I'm going to give you, there's been some changes to the surviving sepsis guidelines, so I'm going to give you the lowdown on what you really need to know. And it's a very practical talk, and so just pay attention. And surgeons can really impact lives by following some key principles. And so, you know, I'm a surgeon, I like simple algorithms, so I made one up. How do I do this? There you go. So this is what you got to know. Save. S-A-V-E. Source control, antibiotics, vascular access, monitoring and support, and equilibrium. Not too much fluid, not too little, maybe a little bit of ECMO. I am from Michigan, after all. So before we go through these real quick, I'm going to talk about some definitions. So there's no such thing as severe sepsis anymore. It's just sepsis. And the way sepsis is defined is that it's a life-threatening organ dysfunction caused by a dysregulated host response to an infection. So look for an infection, labs, cultures, and look for organ dysfunction. So how do we define organ dysfunction? So a real easy way to do that is using what's called a quick SOFA, not the one you sit on at home, but it's a sequential organ failure assessment. And it's made up of three things. So it's mental status changes, elevated respiratory rate, 22 in adults, and a low blood pressure, so less than 100 systolic blood pressure in adults. In kids, you have to use age-appropriate criteria, and the heart rate may be a better marker than blood pressure. So quick SOFA, good way to look at organ dysfunction, mental status, respiratory rate, heart rate slash blood pressure. Sepsis has a 10% mortality rate. So that's 1 in 10. So it's really important to keep that in mind. Septic shock. Now, septic shock, that's a 40% mortality rate. So that's more than 1 in 3 for those who don't know math. And so that's like the, that's you and the two people next to you end up with septic shock. One of you is dead. That's some serious shit. So this is where we got to really take some action. So there's a shock is where your tissues are not getting enough oxygen, so they shift to anaerobic metabolism. That's right, first year med school. And you get a bunch of lactate. So guess what your goal is going to be? Get oxygen to tissues so they don't make lactate. Real simple, right? That's what we got to do. Problem, though, is that we've done this goal-directed resuscitation, and there's been three studies that have been done in the UK, United States, and the Australian New Zealand group, the PROCESS trial, the PROMISE trial, and the ANZUS trial. And all three showed no difference with goal-directed resuscitation or protocol-based resuscitation. However, there's some key principles that are going to be important. Here they are. So let's talk about each of these in some more detail. Source control. So this is also a simple one to remember, four Ds, okay? Drainage, debridement, device removal, and definitive measures, okay? So drainage is going to be IND, evacuate that abscess, put a drain in, get rid of the fluid collection. Debridement, get rid of devitalized tissue. So necrotizing fasciitis, you remove soft tissue, decortication for pleural-based diseases. Device removal is removal of Foley catheter, central lines, and infected mesh. And finally, definitive measures. Definitive measures are resection of bowel for necrotizing enterocolitis, for example. Antibiotics. So start appropriate antibiotics early. For each hour delay in your antibiotics, there's an increase in mortality. So the duration of time between the time you diagnose till when the antibiotics are given increases your mortality. Kumar et al., Critical Care Medicine, 2006. So you gotta give your antibiotics appropriately. So start broad and then de-escalate based on the cultures from your drainage. And make sure you de-escalate and reduce the amount of time that you're on antibiotics. A few things to follow with that will be a procalcitonin measure. So what is procalcitonin? It's a biomarker that's really specific for bacterial infections. So when a trend is more important than a value. So trend your procalcitonin when it reaches normal levels, you can stop your antibiotics. Otherwise, Sean Rangel is gonna come after your ass. The other thing to remember with your antibiotics are, stopping antibiotics is just as important with starting antibiotics. Otherwise, you breed antibiotic resistance. And he's right, this is really important. So in sepsis, we gotta start our antibiotics early, but we also gotta stop our antibiotics on time. So there's a Stop It trial that looked at abdominal sepsis. And it says, in 4 days, you've achieved adequate control that you can stop your antibiotics. Randomized multi-center trial. So 4 days for abdominal sepsis. Next, in terms of the clock starting, right? So this is really important in terms of starting early. It's from the time your blood pressure is checked and is low to when the antibiotics are actually hung. So sometimes that means you gotta get that IV in that first hour. So that's the next step, right? Vascular access. That's where we come in as surgeons again. And so vascular access doesn't just mean two large bore IVs in sepsis. Vascular access means that you might need continuous infusions. So you gotta get a central line in and an arterial line in for monitoring ASAP. I tend to use ultrasound because I don't like to randomly poke at vessels. But you gotta get your lines in. And then your monitoring, I use a lot of ultrasound and echo to help guide my resuscitation. And it's a change from CVP and SWAN numbers. But it's a useful measure because it's dynamic and you can continue to follow it over time. It's at the bedside, it doesn't involve moving anything, and it's a little bit non-invasive in kids who don't need the infusions. In terms of goals for what you're trying to achieve, in terms of lactate, I know I mentioned it earlier, but there was an Andromeda shock study just came out, 2019, Hernandez et al. And JAMA, and it looked at using capillary refill versus lactate as a measure. And what it found was cap refill was just as good as, if not better, than, and this is in pediatrics, just as good as, if not better, than using lactate levels. And that's really important. It had the same amount of 28-day mortality, ventilator-free days, renal replacement-free days. And in fact, there was an almost statistically significant difference in mortality where cap refill had a 35% rate and the lactate level group had a 43% rate with a P of 0.06. So you're like, wow, how is that possible? And it's because the lactate group got a ton more fluid. It was actually over-resuscitation trying to correct that lactate. And over-resuscitation is bad. So it brings me to my next principle, equilibrium. So we know that fluid overload is associated with mortality. And 30 ml per kilo is a good number to use for your sepsis for volume. Isotonic fluid, 30 ml per kilo. So they come in, they're hypotensive, you give them some volume. The FEAST trial, which looked at boluses in children, African children with severe infections, identified that over-resuscitation increased their mortality rate in sepsis in children. And so what you have to do is you have to constantly ask yourself, is this shock really still hypovolemic? Because remember, shock can be four different things. It can be hypovolemic, it can be cardiogenic, it can be neurogenic, or it can be obstructive. So things like tamponade or pneumothoraces, so forth. So once you give your 30 ml per kilo, start considering other things. One, albumin. So the Albios trial looked at ALBIOS trial, looked at use of albumin in sepsis, and was showed that you need to decrease the amount of fluid to achieve your goals. Two, think about blood. So the TRISS trial, TRISS, looked at transfusions in septic shock and identified that a hemoglobin of 7 would be a good adequate number to shoot for. And then third, consider your pressors. So what pressors do you use? So that's where echo is really helpful. Is my SVR low, and what's my heart function like? So those are my two questions, right? So have I given enough volume? Is my heart pumping enough? And is my SVR what I need to address? So typically in kids, I start with dopamine in the babies and norepinephrine for the older children. Most of them have pretty good heart function. And that usually changes if I have somebody with renal failure. So there's a VANISH trial, V-A-N-I-S-H, that looked at vasopressin versus norepinephrine, and vasopressin was a good adjunct to use in those with septic shock and renal failure. So renal failure, think about vasopressin, otherwise norepinephrine, and then dopamine for your first lines. And then in terms of your shock, if you find that you have warm shock, you have adequate blood pressure but inadequate perfusion, so good blood pressure, bad perfusion, use melrinone. Melrinone is a really good adjunct to get blood flowing with the heart. It's a good inotropic support. So really simple. Dopamine or norepi, vasopressin for renal failure, melrinone if you need heart support. So those are good adjuncts to start with. Then as I'm starting my second pressor, if they're not improving, that's when I consider steroids. So there's no data to support using doing a stim test in this setting. As you start your second pressor, start your steroids. Typically, I use hydrocortisone at 1.5 to 2 per kilo every 6 hours. So steroids, second line at the time of my second pressor. And then, so let's walk through this for a second here. So if I have a patient who comes in, say, prefer appendicitis, look sick, look septic, get your drain catheter in, put some IVs in, get a central line in, arterial line, admit into the ICU setting, give them your isotonic fluid boluses, 30 ml per kilo, check their albumin, check their cultures, procalcitonin, antibiotics. We're good so far, right? So patient's still getting worse, not improving, now on two pressors, on hydrocortisone. Think about ECMO. So that final consideration of ECMO is key to remember because ECMO helps with oxygenation and cardiac output, but it has a really difficult time with SVR. So if your systemic vascular resistant SVR is really low, you may still need pressors, even on VA ECMO. So somebody is in severe septic shock, like it's really bad. Even on ECMO, on VA ECMO, you might need to use some pressors. And it's because it gives you oxygenation, it gives you oxygen delivery with cardiac output, but you need something to get your vessels to be tighter. So the other thing with ECMO is don't just crank up the dial to get more flow. So either, so place the largest size cannula you can get, add an additional drainage cannula if you need to, and then consider a central cannulation if you need adequate flows. McLaurin et al. From Australia. If your SVO2 is 70%, you have plenty of flow. At that point, you should start thinking about going back, do I have adequate source control? Am I on appropriate antibiotics? Is my vascular monitoring appropriate? Am I missing something else? Remember, your key is equilibrium. Your final E can also be ECMO, which is in this case. So keep these four concepts in mind to save some lives. Source control, antibiotics, vascular access monitoring support, and equilibrium. Remember, sepsis is a surgical problem. Fellow surgeons, let's save some fucking lifetimes. Thank you.
Outstanding presentations. I think you've energized us, you've inspired us, and quite frankly, you've challenged us. But what you must understand that this really just starts the discussion. This just starts the discussion. There won't be, these are like TED Talks. You're not going to get any questions, any chance for questions today, but I can count on when we move out of the sea, those questions will come, and we're going to try to change things based on things today. So an extra round of thanks to all five of our speakers for this morning's session. Thank you. My only final remark is that during this last year in February, we lost one of our PDC stalwarts, Dan Ledbetter. Dan was a remarkable human being. He was always, quite frankly, better read than any of us at the table, and we miss him dearly. This concludes the sessions for this morning. Thank you.